वक्रतुण्ड महाकाय सूर्यकोटि समप्रभा निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा। अनंत संसार समुद्र तार नौकायिताभ्यां गुरुभक्तिदाभ्यां वैराग्य साम्राज्यद पूजनाभ्यां नमो नमः श्री गुरुपादुकाभ्यां नमो नमः श्री गुरुपादुकाभ्यां नमो नमः श्री गुरुपादुकाभ्यां। श्री विद्या शिववामभागनिलयां ह्रीङ्कार मन्त्रोज्ज्वलां श्रीचक्रांकित बिन्दुमध्यवसतीं श्रीमत् सभा नायिकां श्रीमत् षण्मुख विघ्नराज जननी श्रीमत् जगन् मोहिनी मीनाक्षीं प्रणतोऽस्मि सन्ततमहं कारुण्यवारानिधिं सिन्धूरारुण विग्रहां त्रिनयनां माणिक्यमौलि स्फुर तारानायक शेखरां स्मितमुखीं आपीनवक्षोरुहां पाणिभ्यां अलिपूर्ण रत्नचषकं रक्तोत्पलं बिभ्रती सौम्यां रत्नघटस्तरक्तचरणां ध्याये परां अम्बिकां। शरज्योत्स्नाशुद्धां शशियुतजटाजूटमकुटां वरत्रासत्राणस्फटिकघुटिका पुस्तककरां सकृन्नत्वा नत्वा कथमिव सतां सन्निदधते मधु क्षीरद्राक्षा मधुरी मधुरीणाः फणितयः। कुण्डलिकुमारिकुटिले चण्डिचराचर सवित्रि चामुण्डे गुणिनि गुहारिणि गुह्ये गुरुमूर्ते त्वां नमामि कामाक्षि गुरुमूर्ते त्वां नमामि कामाक्षि। गुरुमूर्ते त्वां नमामि कामाक्षी। I offer my most humble prostrations to the lotus feet of my Guru, who is verily the Divine Mother. I hereby will be starting expounding on the meanings of Lalita Sahasranam just out of pure love for the Divine Mother and pure gratitude for my Master, for my Guru. Neither I have read the Shastras nor have done any kind of study of the Vedas, but just as a little child blabbers and says ma 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 ma, just the word ma ma is enough to make the heart of a mother blossom, so is my effort in saying meanings of the names of the Divine Mother with pure love for her and gratitude for my Master. And it's only the ashray that his lotus feet have provided me, I take up this audacity to expound on the names of the Divine Mother. I seek his grace, I seek his blessings. And Divine Mother, as a little child, I'm just blabbering the meanings of your name, but I know you're smiling because you're just happy listening to ma, 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 ma from your child. So out of pure love for you and pure gratitude for my Master, I will start. So before we get into the meanings of Lalita Sahasranam, it is important to know how did it come about, the avatarika, how did it come about, who gave it to who. At the end of the Lalita Sahasranam chanting, we say, Brahmanda Purane Uttarakhande Shri Hayagriva Agastya Samvade Shri Lalita Sahasranama Stotram. So Lalita Sahasranam, as we know from the last verse, it was given to Agastya Rishi. It was a conversation between Agastya Rishi and Hayagriva in the Uttarakhanda Brahmanda Purana. So today's recording will only be on the avatarika of Lalita Sahasranam. And then we will talk a little bit about Lalitopakhyan, and then we will get into the names of the Divine Mother. So talking about the avatarika, how did it come about? Agastya Rishi, along with his wife Lopamudra, were doing Kshetra Yatra along Mother India. Just on their foot, they were doing Kshetra Yatra. As they were doing the Kshetra Yatra, visiting many holy places, see, they were watching how the entry of Kali Yuga had really affected people. And the best definition of Kali Yuga is the yuga in which people are not cordial to each other. They are either jealous, angry, in competition, trying to push each other to move forward. Any kind of action that is not cordial is because of Kali Yuga. So as him and his wife Lopamudra was the name of the wife of the Rishi, as they were walking and doing their Kshetra Yatra along Bharat, they saw people. And you know, when I say people, there are always two kinds of people, one with Daivi Gun, one majority with Daivi Gun, and one majority with Asuri Gun. demonic qualities and godlike qualities, sattvic and rajasic and tamasic qualities. So the inspiration or the motivation to walk towards self-realization, atma sakshatkar or god realization cannot arise in the antakaran of someone with asuric qualities. It is only people with daivi sampatti, devi sanskar, daivik gun or god-like qualities. It's only in such people will the inspiration or motivation to walk towards self-realization arises. Which is why the first step is yam niyam. Even in Patanjali Yoga Sutras, he says, first, learn to walk the path of dharma. Learn to develop devi qualities in yourself. Then you will be eligible to walk the path of God realization or self-realization. So when Agastya Rishi along with his wife Lopamudra were walking and doing their Kshetra Yatra, they saw how people with Daivi Gun, because of Kali Yuga being prevalent, were really getting pulled down from the surrounding, from the effect of the surroundings, and because of the Kali Prabhav within them. And that's when, and they were watching this as they were going through the different areas. And, you know, watching this over a period of time, it created some amount of distress in Agastya Rishi. And that is how a Rishi is separate from a common man. A common man is constantly bothered about his good, his well-being, his welfare. Whereas a Rishi is always, always bothered about others, about the welfare of others. So he was in some amount of distress looking at how much these people with Daivi Gun, who had the potential to walk the path of self-realization, were being pulled down in their efforts by the effect of the Kali Yuga on the surroundings and within themselves. And how the people with asuric qualities were not able to fight the asuric qualities within to start earning the Daivi Gun or the Daivik Sampatti or the God-like Sampatti. And they were suffering, being dragged further down in the demonic qualities. They saw this and he was in distress. Finally, they reached Kanchipuram. Kanchipuram is where, Kanchipuram is considered the Kashi of Dakshin. Like Kashi of Uttar Bharat, Dakshin Bharat Kashi is Kanchi, Kanchipuram. That is where the Divine Mother resides as Ma Jagdamba, as Lalita Mahatripur Sundari, as Jagan Mata. So he reached there after offering his prayers to Ma Jagdamba. He sat down under a tree, and the taap, the distress that he was experiencing, the taap that he was experiencing because of witnessing the effect of Kali Yuga on people with Daivi Gun and on people with Asuri Gun, that taap turned into tapas. The distress turned into penance as he sat under that tree. And he sat there in that distress, which turned into penance. And his penance was just praying, saying, what can be done? There has to be some way of helping these people. And in response to that tapas, after a long while, it doesn't matter, depending upon his intensity of his tapas, after a while, a jyoti appeared in front of him. Pure light, jyoti. Eventually that jyoti swarup took a form, and that form was that of Hayagriva Swami. Bolo Hayagriva Swami ki jai. With a horse face. Pitambar Dhari with a horse face. So Hayagriva Swami is actually the Guru Swarup of Lord Vishnu. So when Hayagriva Swami appeared, who is nothing but the Guru Swarup of Lord Vishnu, with the horse face, Pitambar, everything like Lord Vishnu, but with a horse face. When he appeared, he said, I know what you're worried about, Agastya. I have already read your mind. Agastya fell at his feet and first did his kirti in many beautiful shlokas, and then folded on his knees, folded his hands, put his head down in front of Hayagriva Swami, and he said, I'm really worried for people in this Kali Yuga, especially the ones with Daivi Gun. They have the potential to walk the path of self-realization, but they are not able to. And the people with Asuri Sampatti, they are not getting inspired to work on their bad qualities so they can attain more of the good qualities to be able to be eligible to walk on the path of self-realization. I am at a loss. Please guide me. Tell me, what is it that can be done? What is it that these people can do in order to save themselves, in order to walk the path of self-realization and eventually realize their true self? Help me. Help them. So Hayagriva Rishi, Hayagriva Swami, who was the Guru Swarup of Lord Vishnu, took the form of a Rishi, who is also called the Hayagriva Rishi. Because every avatar has a prayojan, has a use or a purpose. When Hayagriva Swami appeared as a jyoti that took a form, it was to bless Agastya. But to give the gyan, he took the form of Hayagriva Rishi. So then Hayagriva Rishi sat down. Agastya Rishi, of course, made him sit down, washed his feet, because a guru, now he accepted Hayagriva Swami, who appeared as Hayagriva Rishi, as the guru. He made him sit down, washed his feet, did Paduka Puja, offered his many, many prostrations, sat down at his feet with folded hands, head down, and he said, please tell me, please tell me. That was the humility of Agastya Rishi. Although he was a Siddha, he was already a Maharshi by then, but when Hayagriva Rishi said, I will give you that gyan, when he became the guru, instantly with all his humility, he became the shishya. He said, tell me, what is it that people can do? Hayagriva Rishi smiled and he said, in this Kali Yuga, the best way to be able to walk the path of self-realization and eventually reach self-realization is by upasana of Ma Jagdamba, of upasana of Jagan Mata. And he said, when one listens to the glories of the mother, when one listens to the charitra of the mother, when one listens to the various avatars that she has taken, and after listening टू सो मच अबाउट द डिवाइन मदर, हर ग्लोरीज, हर तत्व, हर स्वरूप, हर भाव. व्हेन सच अ पर्सन्स माइंड गेट्स फिल्ड विथ नो स्पेस लेफ्ट, बिकॉज द माइंड इज लाइक एन आकाश, इट्स फिल्ड विथ थॉट्स. बट टू फिल दैट माइंड विथ कंप्लीटली विथ मदर्स चरित्र, हर कीर्ति, हर ग्लोरीज, हर स्टोरीज, हर वेरियस अवतार्स, हर फॉर्म. व्हेन द माइंड इज फिल्ड विथ ऑल ऑफ दैट, सच अ माइंड इज नाउ एलिजिबल, सच अ पर्सन विल अचीव चित्त शुद्धि. आफ्टर सेइंग दैट हयग्रीव ऋषि केप्ट क्वाइट. अगस्त्य ऋषि, एज सून एज ही हर्ड दैट, ही हेल्ड द फीट ऑफ हयग्रीव ऋषि एंड ही सेड, माय मास्टर, डोंट स्टॉप देयर, टेल मी द चरित्र ऑफ द डिवाइन मदर, टेल मी हर कीर्तिज, हर ग्लोरीज, आई वॉन्ट टू हियर ऑल द स्टोरीज दैट आर देयर, टेल मी ऑल द कथाज, ऑल द स्टोरीज, ऑल द अवतार्स, डोंट स्टॉप, जस्ट टेल मी, आई एम वेरी ईगर टू लिसन. व्हेन अगस्त्य ऋषि सेड दैट, दैट्स व्हेन हयग्रीव ऋषि स्टार्टेड टेलिंग फर्दर. ही सेड, धन्योस्मि, यू आर धन्य अगस्त्य, द इंक्लिनेशन यू शो टूवर्ड्स नोइंग मोर अबाउट द डिवाइन मदर, दैट इज ट्रूली अ ब्लेसिंग. That shows that the mother is already happy with you. Of course, I am here to tell you all her glories. Let us both listen to the glories of the Divine Mother. Be attentive, Agastya. Now I am going to start telling you the charitra of the Divine Mother. As soon as he said that, Agastya Rishi, in all his attentiveness, and it is not that a Maharshi like Agastya Rishi would be daydreaming or would be sleeping. But whenever a very important aspect is coming up and the master wants the disciple to pay extra attention, the master says, be attentive. I am about to start telling you the charitra of the Divine Mother. So by after saying this, he starts. He says, first, try to understand who Divine Mother is. I'm going to first give you a summary. After I give you the summary, I will expound further. Even in Bhagavad Gita, first is the Arjun Vishad Yoga. Without Vishad, there can be no knowledge. So Arjun started with the Vishad Yoga. After that, in the second chapter, entire Bhagavad Gita is being given as like a summary, as like in a capsule form, if you may. Completely concise form of Bhagavad Gita is chapter 2. Similarly, Hayagriva Rishi said, I will explain to you first who Jagan Mata is, and then we'll talk about her charitra. And then he says, the one who is anadi, she doesn't have a beginning or an end. The one who can be known by dhyan. The one who is nothing but Paramatma or his Shakti. It's like, you know, if you take a jyoti and its kanti. Jyoti being the deepak, kanti being the light emanating from that deepak. So he said, Paramatma is the one that is the foundation for everything happening around you. So at the macrocosmic level, if we see everything that's happening around us, there is a substratum to it. That substratum is the Divine Mother. The Karana Parachidrupa, Karano ke piche karan, Parakaran. If you start tracing the cause of everything there is to the ultimate end, after some time, there is nothing but Paramatma. Iske piche, uske piche, uske, the ultimate karan. He says, first of all, understand this Divine Mother is the Karan Parachidrupa. She is the foundation, the substratum upon which this entire universe is held. Although she holds the entire universe, she does not need any kind of support. She is self-sufficient. She is anadi. She has ever been there. There is never a time that she was not there. There will not be a time that she won't be there. And she is always present. Such a mother can be realized by dhyanagamya. Such a mother can be worshipped by bhakti. So describing the Divine Mother, such, he started explaining the tattva. So like a deepak with its kanti. Is the kanti different than the deepak? Is the light bulb and the light, or the sun and the rays of the sun? They are not different. Because the sun exists, sun's rays exist. The sun, although is so far away, the sun's rays reach all the way to us. Each of the sun ray, the sun's rays collectively are the Divine Mother. The sun is Paramatma. Paramatma and Paramatma's Shakti. He explained all this, saying, at the macrocosmic level, if you want to look at the sun and its rays, the sun being the Paramatma, the rays being the Divine Mother. Similarly, at the microcosmic level, there is something within us that makes us separate from our dead body. That something is the Divine Mother. She is also the Paramatma and Paramatma's Shakti. Just like the sunlight is not different than the sun itself, the Shakti that is within our body everywhere is not separate from that which makes us alive. Now, when we talk about the body, there is the sthula sharir, the gross body. Then there is subtle body. The gross body being this human body. There is something within us that makes this human body alive at this moment. That something, when it leaves, this body becomes a dead body. So that is what we are talking about. That is at the core of our being. And that core of our being is the Paramatma. And Paramatma's Shakti is spreading to the entire body. Each cell of the body has the Shakti reaching it. Each organ system has a local intelligence. So this entire body, if you consider the Paramatma as the sun within the very core of our being, the entire body is nothing but the light of that sun. Like when the sun rays are coming through a window, we see multiple particles in it. Right? When you go close, you see multiple particles. Now imagine if those particles get denser and denser and denser. It will take up a form. And that can be a human body. So the light within us shines through the entire gross body, making it alive. Because as soon as that Paramatma within leaves, the body is shed, the body becomes a dead body. That is as far as the gross body is concerned. There is also the subtle body, which is the mind, the emotions, the intellect. Every movement in the mind happens because we are alive. A dead body cannot think. A dead body cannot have desires. A dead body cannot have emotions. So every movement in the mind is again because of the presence of the sun or the Paramatma within us. And the movement in the mind is the Divine Mother herself. The movement in the buddhi is the Divine Mother. The movement in the emotions is the Divine Mother, the source of which being the Paramatma within. So if Paramatma is to be worshipped based upon your individual inclination as Lord Shiva, then all the waves is Mother Parvati or Ma Shakti. But here we are talking about Adya Shakti and Paramatma. Paramatma and his Shakti. So the entire human body, the entire mind, the entire buddhi, all the desires, all the thoughts, all the emotions are nothing but movement of the Divine Mother, are nothing but the Divine Mother. Each ray of the sun travels all the way from far off sun to us. So each ray of the sun starts at the sun and reaches us. Similarly, the Divine Mother is called Shiva Jnana Pradayini, which means only the Mother can take hold our hand and take us back to our source, keep us connected with the source, lovingly walk us back to our Divine Father or Paramatma. Again, Paramatma and Paramatma's Shakti being one and the same, which is the Ardhanarishwar Swaroop. So he explained Hayagriva Rishi again, coming back to Hayagriva Rishi and Agastya Muni sitting in front of him. Hayagriva Rishi first explained the Tattva of Divine Mother. He said, understand this first, Agastya, that she is the substratum upon which everything happens outside of the human body and inside of the human body. Just like the ocean and the waves, there could be many, many waves, many different shapes, many different sizes. They are all made up of the same water that is in the deeper waters. Similarly, the deepest, coremost aspect of us is that Paramatma. And everything we see on the surface, the human body, the mind, the thoughts, the desires, the emotions, everything is made up of the same light that emanates from the Paramatma within. And that light traveling from Paramatma within to every aspect of the human body, sthul and sukshma, is the Divine Mother. Similarly, at the macrocosmic level, the Paramatma and his entire creation being his Shakti. Just like the sun's rays are not separate from the sun, this creation, entire creation with all its forms, every little aspect of it is Divine Mother. So he first explained this. Then he said to Agastya, now I will tell you the three main forms that Ma Jagdamba, that Adya Shakti, took, and this is part of her charitra. He said the first form she took is Prakriti. Prakriti. Kriti means that which has been made. Pra is the cause behind that which has been made. So that which, let's first consider that which has been made. Let's first look outside of us at the macrocosmic level. Everything we see around us is absolutely made up of the Pancha Mahabhut. Space, air, fire, water, earth. No matter what you take, everything has varying combinations. It's a permutation and combination of these five elements. So Kriti is that which has been made. So first we consider everything that has been made outside at the macrocosmic level. Next, let's come to the microcosmic level, that which has been made. Our body is also made up of the five panchamahabhut. There is no denying that. Now let's come to the pra. That which is the cause of the effect. The effect is Kriti. Kriti is that which has been made. by what is pra. Prakriti, which means the cause and the effect combined, is her form. Which means at the macrocosmic level, if you see, everything there is made up of the various permutations and combinations of the Panchamahabhut. Not only what you see, but there is something that you don't see, which is the cause. You see the effect, but the cause is hidden. But the hidden cause and the manifest effect are both her. What can you conclude? The entire creation as is the Divine Mother herself. And as we go into Lalita Sahasranam, we will see how the first 20 verses talk about her Vishwa Vigraha, which means the entire creation as her body. So whatever we see outside at the macrocosmic level, Kriti and the Prakriti outside is entirely the Divine Mother. At the microcosmic level, this entire body, the mind, the intellect, emotions, everything within this body is nothing but the light of Paramatma within. That light being the Divine Mother, which is not separate from the source of the light, which is the Paramatma. The reason I'm saying Paramatma and Divine Mother separate is because when we are in our deep sleep, where we are not even dreaming, we are in pure consciousness, which is we are that Paramatma. There is absolutely no movement, no dreams, nothing. No sansar, no body, there is no movement. That is Paramatma. But as soon as we wake up, the aham bhav, oh, I am awake. I am at my house awake. I am awake now that I'll do this. It all starts with I am. That aham bhav is the Divine Mother. Mahakamesh Mahishi. Mahakamesh is Paramatma. Mahishi is the aham bhav of Paramatma. She is the aham bhav of Paramatma. In deep sleep, there is no aham bhav. There just is. But as soon as we wake up, I am awake. I am, and fill in the blank. You can put anything. I am a woman who is awake. I am a man who is awake. I am a father who is awake. I am a mother. You can put many, many labels. But the common substratum being I am. The first thing is I am. After that, okay, let me wake up. Let me do this. Let me do this. Me is aham. Aham Brahmasmi. So we're talking about the first form of the Divine Mother. Because now Hayagriva Rishi is expounding on the charitra of the Divine Mother. And in expounding the charitra of the Divine Mother, he first talks about the first form that the Divine Mother took, which is, excuse me, let me fix that statement. He talks about the first form of the Divine Mother assumed. She took that form. So the first form being Prakriti, which is everything that you see around us, within us, and the cause behind it. The effect and the cause together is Prakriti. In Prakriti, she appears as five Swaroop: Durga, Lakshmi, Saraswati, Gayatri, Radha. Durga is the Shakti based upon which she can become the substratum for everything to exist. Lakshmi is the Aishwarya that she provides. So everything that we see around us is nothing but her Aishwarya. Within us, the greatest Aishwarya that we have is we are alive. What is it that separates me from my dead body? That is the greatest treasure I have. Because once that leaves, whatever I may have outside or inside is of no use. So the greatest Aishwarya is Lakshmi. So Durga is the Shakti with which she becomes the substratum of everything there is. Lakshmi is the Aishwarya. Saraswati is the Jnana Swarupa. There is Jnana around us everywhere. If you are looking at a table, there are Pancha Mahabhut in there. There is some amount of water, there is some amount of earth, there is some amount of air in different combinations. But don't forget the intelligence that makes pieces of wood into a usable table. That's Saraswati. That's the Jnana Swarupa, everything around us. There is some amount of knowledge which is what makes the Pancha Mahabhut or the combination of Pancha Mahabhut into some usable form. So, Saraswati. So, we talked about the Shakti that forms the substratum. The Lakshmi that forms the Aishwarya or the Sampada of everything that is without and within, outside and inside, the Saraswati or the Gyan Swarupa, how to run the circulatory system, how to run the respiratory system, the digestive system, the gastrointestinal, everything. There is certain amount of knowledge required. Saraswati. Gayatri. Gayatri is the Dhyoyonah Prachodayat, Buddhi Swarupa. So, Paramatma within us is the sun. Light rays emanating from that Paramatma is this entire human body at all levels, Sthul, Sukshma and Karan. And then, so, as Ma Gayatri, she is the Buddhi Shakti. Buddhi Shakti that makes us aware of the presence of Paramatma within. Which is why the Gayatri Sadhana, it makes us aware of her presence within us. And then finally is Radha or the Prema Swarupa. Paramatma's Prema Shakti is Radha. She does all this not out of compulsion, but out of pure love. That's her swarup. So as Prakriti, she takes up five in the avatar as Prakriti, she takes up five Shakti swarup. First being Durga, being the substratum of everything there is. Mother Lakshmi as the Aishwarya or the Sampada. Mother Saraswati as the Jnana. Mother Gayatri as the Buddhi, Shuddha Buddhi. And Mother Radha as the Prem Shakti. So then again Hayagriva Rishi is expounding the Charitra of the Divine Mother to Agastya Rishi. And he's expounding on the first form of the Divine Mother, which is Prakriti. Why is it important to hear all this about the Divine Mother? Why can't we jump straight into Lalita Sahasranam? It is important to know, to hear so much, so that the chitta gets completely filled with her glories, with her stories, with her leelas, with her smile, with her swaroop. There is no room for any other thoughts. Paramantra Vibhedini, that's her name in Lalita Sahasranam. Paramantra Vibhedini, which means she makes sure that the mind only chants her mantra. No paramantra. Paramantra is any other thought, any stray thought. Paramantra Vibhedini. She completely destroys any other thought except for her thought. A mantra is nothing but a thought. Paramantra Vibhed. So that's what she does. So, again, expounding on the various forms that she took, Hayagriva Rishi said the first form, Agastya, is that of Prakriti. Then he said the second form is that of Mohini. And we all know so much about this Mohini avatar, that how during Samudra Manthan, finally at the end, when Lord Vishnu took the form of Dhanvantri and came up with Amrit Kalash, all the asuras jumped up and grabbed it, and now they had the Amrit, and they were not willing to give it back. So in order to get it back from them, Lord Vishnu took the Mohini avatar. And we all know how she basically, his Maya, Vishnu Maya, Vilasini, Vishnu's Maya as Mohini completely took over the whole scene, and how she took the Amrit Kalash away from the Rakshasas and started giving it to the Devas. We all are very aware of this story, but there is some antarath that we need to understand. First of all, we need to understand what is that Amrit. Amrit is nothing but the Jnana, Jnanamrit. But that Jnanamrit, the asuras are not qualified to have the Jnanamrit, because until and unless the Daivi Sampatti or the divine qualities are developed within us, we are not eligible for that Jnana. Because if Jnana is given to a chitta that is not ripe yet, it can create misunderstanding. And it can create misunderstanding, and it can create akarmata, which means people will stop doing what they're supposed to do because their chitta is not ripened. They are not ready to receive that Brahma Gyan, which is why divine qualities, developing divine qualities, make us eligible to walk the path of self-realization. So the asuras were not eligible to receive the Jnanamrit. The devas were. So divine, so Mohini Swarup now. Let's talk about Mohini. Jagannath, Jagan Mohini. The same Jagannath, Lord Vishnu's name is Jagannath. Jagannath became Jagan Mohini. When the asuras were looking at Jagan Mohini, when they were looking at the Mohini Swarup of the Divine Mother, they were attracted to her. When the devas were looking at the Mohini Swarup of the Divine Mother, they were looking at their mother. They were looking at her with motherly love. That is why they were given Amrit, Jnanamrit, whereas the asuras were kept devoid of it. So when we look at Prakriti as Jagan Mohini, we become attracted to it. Then our senses become like those uncontrollable horses that drive our chariot without any charioteer. Then the senses are, it's like a chariot without a charioteer. The horses are going haywire in every direction, creating a havoc on that chariot and the person riding the chariot, the Jivatma, because of the perspective, which is why the first thing that the Divine Mother will transform in her loving child is the perspective. She says, when you look at the world, when you look at your body, don't get attracted to it. It's all me, it's all my own Maya. Look at it as the divine, as your own mother. Because of habit patterns, it is not going to be a switch that is going to change, and our perspective will change eventually. It is with practice. It is slowly by the grace of the Divine Mother, little bit of efforts on our part, a lot of grace on her part. This combination will help us switch our perspective completely eventually. Slowly understanding that prakriti, that which you see as the effect, has a cause to it. That cause plus effect is nothing but the Divine Mother. Mohini is the Maya that keeps people from knowing that she is the Divine Mother. Both the Asuras and the Devas were looking at the same woman. One group of people were getting attracted to her form. The other group were in complete reverence on seeing their own mother. What was the difference? The divine qualities within us help us make our perspective different, clearer. We are able to see things as they are, not as how they should be. So that is the first place Vairagya starts coming in the Bija Swarup. When you hear about the Divine Mother and when you find out that this whole entire creation is her body, when you look at your body and you realize it is nothing but the light of Paramatma as the Divine Mother, the Akarshan or the attraction starts becoming lesser and lesser. And that's how Vairagya, being a little tiny sapling, starts growing. So entire Samudra Manthan on the Mohini Avatar is to show that this Jagat can be looked upon in two ways. The first way is Bhog. Let me go enjoy. I'm attracted to everything here. Let me just go enjoy. Let me eat good food. Let me wear good clothes. Let me glorify my body. Let me just completely Bhog ki drishti. That is Jagan Mohini. Looking at Jagat as Jagan Mohini. But the other way is looking at the same Jagat with a Jagannath or Jagan Mata perspective. And as I said, it will take some time for this perspective to become paripakva. That's what Lord Buddha says, samyak drishti. Samyak is complete perfection in your perspective. It will not happen in a switch. It will happen slowly. Dhire dhire re mana, dhire sab kuch hoy. So very, very slowly this perspective will change. Little bit of efforts, a lot of grace. It will have this effect. Then we start looking at our own self, our own body, as nothing but the light of Paramatma within. We start seeing this entire creation as the Divine Mother herself. So samyak drishti. So the Mohini Avatar is all about what perspective one should have when we look at the Jagat without and within, both ways. So that was about the Mohini Avatar. And then there is also, within the Mohini Avatar, there is Jagan Mohini and Shiva Mohini Avatar. Shiva Mohini is when, after the Samudra Manthan, Narad Rishi goes to Lord Shiva and describes the entire incident, and he says, listen, you left after taking the halahal, the poison, but at the very end, you know, your Isht Hari, he took a form of a beautiful woman. You really missed out. That's when Lord Shiva goes to Lord Vishnu and he says, would you not take that form for me again? And upon his request, Lord Vishnu thinks you know, this person who is sitting in front of me asking me to become a woman has completely burnt up all the desires in the form of Kamdev. He has burnt up the source of all desires. I cannot believe he wants to look at me as a woman. And that's when he realizes it is indeed his own Shakti that can make him mohit. So with that, he prays to the Divine Mother. Haristvama aradhyam pranatajana saubhagya jananim puranari bhutva purarepum apikshobhamanayat. In Saundarya Lahari, Adi Guru Shankaracharya says that Lord Hari, he prayed to you and became this beautiful woman, Shiva Mohini, who also made Lord Shiva, who himself opened his third eye and completely burnt up Kamdev, completely mohit. So that is the Shiva Mohini avatar. And out of that beautiful union came Lord Ayyappa, who is Hariharatmajam. Because there was a Rakshas who would only be who said that I want a boon that I may only be killed by the divine union of Hari and Hara, which is Lord Vishnu and Lord Shiva. Knowing that that would never happen, the Rakshas wished for that. But then this is how Lord Vishnu prayed to the Divine Mother. The Divine Mother became Shiva Mohini, blessed Lord Hari with her form, became Shiva Mohini, and out of that divine union came about Lord Ayyappa, who eventually killed that Asura. That was the Mohini avatar of the Divine Mother. And then he says, now I will tell you the last avatar of the Divine Mother, which is Sri Lalita Parabhattarika, Sri Lalita Tripura Sundari, or Sri Lalita Devi. Actually, Hayagriva Rishi ended his conversation saying, and the third roop is that of Lalita Devi. And he kept quiet. But Agastya Rishi was listening with such rapture. He held Hayagriva Rishi's feet and he said, don't stop there, my lord. Tell me about Lalita Devi Charitra. I am very eager to hear more about what happened. Tell me, don't stop there. That shows the intent with which Agastya Rishi was listening, and that shows how Hayagriva Rishi was being careful and not just letting everything out. He was making sure that the listener is actually paying attention and has this strong inclination, strong desire to hear more about the Divine Mother. That's when he continued. So with this, we will end the satsang today. Tomorrow, we are going to take up the charitra of Lalita Devi, of the Divine Mother in her third form, which is Lalita Devi. Sarvam Shri Jagadamba Charanarpanamastu. I offer everything at the feet of my Master, who is verily the Divine Mother herself. Jagan Mata, Jagan Mata, Jagan Mata, Jagan Matruke, Pahimam, Pahimam, Pahimam. Om Purnamadaha, Purnamidam, Purnat, Purnamudachate, Purnasya, Purnamadaya, Purnameva Vashishate. Om Shantihi, Shantihi, Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.